Good afternoon. Welcome. I'm very glad to see you and to have you here today, both here in the room and as we're delighted at this point to be able to continue to offer, even in some extended ways, to a community that is gathering with us, I know, online as well for each of these programs. And we're so glad to be able to do that. I'm John Sal. I'm the Director of Music Ministries here, and I'm very glad to have you with us for this chamber music program as we are sort of making our way through the spring and near to the end of this season's programming. It's always good to gather on a beautiful day when it's nice to come out, but also nice to share in the music. And so there are just a couple of details I want to highlight for you in the program, and then we'll be off and on to music soon. First of all, on the back of the program, you'll see the remaining listed concerts for this season. That includes a program in May with the community orchestra here, the Abington Symphony Orchestra, and some guest soloists. I'm very excited about those collaborations. It includes the world premiere of Ryan Green's piece called Monarca. He is a very talented young artist who is a senior in high school, but part of the Marian Anderson Young Artist Program under the Play On Philly umbrella of programming in the city. He's headed on to conservatory in the fall and has lots of great things, I know, awaiting next steps in his career, but we're thrilled to have the opportunity to present him. We also have a more traditional Goltermann cello concerto on that same program by a longtime collaborator and friend with the orchestra, Ajibola Rivers. And so it's a wonderful chance to hear lots of different kinds of sounds and lots of different kinds of expressions from the orchestra. Will be a great program in that way. And then a Billie Holiday program on June 2nd that I'll let you do a little online exploring, because it's a wonderful chance to get to know about the music, the passions, the advocacy, and the impact of Billie Holiday, and will be a great way for us to end the year in June together, I hope. I also want to let you know that we are right now in the process of putting together both plans and schedules for next season. If you are not already on either the Facebook group or on the email list for Music at Abington concert updates, I would encourage you to leave that either today with one of the ushers or with myself to make sure that you get onto that list, so that as we're planning for next season, you'll know what's being offered here, can put those dates onto calendars, and join us all season long again. It's a nice way to share in the music and in community. Inside of that back cover or back page of the program, you'll see a list of donors who have made this season possible. Our format here financially is that everything we do, we offer for free to the community, really wanting this to be an outreach, a place of meeting, and a chance to share in music, arts, and community in a number of ways. To that end, we offer childcare, professional childcare during all of our programs. Today, that's just through this door and across the hallway. We have receptions at almost every program that we offer as a way for you to share in the experience with the artists and with one another as fellow listeners. And the programs are offered without a ticket price. However, everything that we do, from the professional childcare to receptions themselves, printing an in-house structure that we have with support from the church ministries, and then particularly, of course, all of the artists and other infrastructure of the music series itself, are supported by patron donations and by in-concert or per-concert offerings. If you are able to make an offering today or are planning to do that, we will welcome it. You'll see there's a place where just before we take a short intermission, we'll receive an offering by passing plates right in the pews. But we don't expect you to do that. It's just a way to continue support the music going forward if you're able and planning to do that today. We're mostly glad that you're here and have a chance to share in this program together. And then, just about the program itself, I want to note that originally planned was a trio program for today, and what we are offering and what you are getting is a wonderful duo program. So I guess that's two-thirds of what you might have been expecting. It is still a full program in every way, and you're in for a musical highlight and a treat. but due to a change that just made it impossible for the trio to all perform together today, Vivian Barton Dozor and Diane Goldsmith asked if it would be possible, rather than seek a change of time or venue, which at this time of year is so hard to accomplish, if they would present this as a duo program instead. I'm delighted by the program that they've come up with and put together for us, and on fairly short notice, and really glad to have you here to join and experience it as well. Those are my sort of announcement-y announcements. The last thing I want to do is to say a word of welcome and a word of introduction. I'm really delighted today to call upon a new colleague who is here as Abington Presbyterian Church's head of staff and our pastor, the Reverend Sudie Neeson-Thompson. She's going to offer a word of invocation to welcome us into this space of holy music making and holy community together. And then we'll welcome the duo with our applause to the stage after she's done. I'm glad that you're here. Sudie.
Thank you, John. And I would like to echo John's words of welcome to you, although I realize that's kind of a funny thing, since I think today is my fifth Sunday here at Abington Presbyterian Church. So many, if not most of you, who have been in this sanctuary far more times than I have. But still, I would like to welcome you, and I'm so glad to be with you here today. Friends, let us pray. Holy One, the psalmist exhorts the entire earth to make a joyful noise before you. And so, as we enter into this sacred space, we gather with thanksgiving on our lips. We glorify you with the sound of piano and strings, with instruments tuned for praise. Tune our hearts also to sing your praise, and open our eyes and ears to behold your goodness, reflected back to us through the blessing of gifts shared, through beautiful harmonies and rhythms that soothe or uplift. May the music we are about to hear comfort and inspire us, so that we might go forth to offer the world gifts of beauty and grace. This we pray in the name of all that is holy, all that is good, and let the people say, Amen.
Test? Okay, there we go. Welcome to today's program titled Something Borrowed. The idea for today's concert occurred when our pianist, Diane Goldsmith, after playing a few different programs with our cellist, Vivian Barton Dozor, and noticing that a number of works were originally written for other instruments or were transcriptions. But the concept for today's program goes a bit farther than that. One of the pieces, and I'm referring specifically to the one by Beethoven, is based on a famous operatic duet. Another piece, the one by Bartok, the operatic duets are by Mozart, I left that point out. Another piece, this one by Bartok, was based on dance tunes he heard in Transylvania. And the piece by William Bolcom, a living American composer, was inspired by ragtime, a style long defunct by the time he wrote his Graceful Ghost Rag in 1970. The pianists among you in our audience will recognize our first selection as an etude for piano by Chopin. We're presenting it in an arrangement by Alexander Glazunov, who was a composer from the late Russian Romantic period. Next, we have a work by Clara Schumann, one of the most distinguished pianists of the Romantic era, and a composer of solo piano pieces, piano concerti, chamber music, choral pieces, and songs. Her Three Romances was written in 1853 when she was 34 years old, and she'd already given birth to seven of her eight children with composer Robert Schumann. It was written, you wonder if she ever found time to compose. It was written for violin and is played by cellists today by playing their part down an octave. Clara dedicated it to the legendary violinist Josef Jakun, with whom she toured and performed the work to high praise. In our time, London music critic Stephen Pettit wrote of the romances, lush and poignant. They make one regret that Clara's career as a composer became subordinate to that of Robert's. Thank you. Our next selection was written by Robert Schumann just over a few days in 1849, during one of the happier periods of his life when he was living in Dresden. He originally had the clarinet in mind for this piece, but he also indicated it could be played by either cello or violin, a concession to the market for home entertainment at the time. The title, Fantasiestücke, was one of his favorites and reflects the Romantic era credo of personal subjectivity in composition, where the contrasts in mood are juxtaposed with wonderful spontaneity. Here is Robert Schumann's Fantasiestücke, Opus 73.
Thank you.
Go far. We'll be back soon with more great music. Okay, we're ready for the second half now. Along with five sonatas for cello and piano, Beethoven wrote two sets of variations for cello based on tunes from Die Zauberflöte, the Magic Flute by Mozart, his favorite Mozart opera, as a matter of fact. Vivian and Diane will play the second set, written in 1801, based on Bei Mannern, Welche Liebe fühlen, the love duet that Papageno sings in Act I of the opera with Pamina. According to cellist David Morgenstern, Beethoven actually improved on Mozart's elegant material with this brilliant set of variations. So, here are the variations on Bei Mannern.
Thank you.
Our next work by American composer William Bolcom, who in the 1960s was writing the serial technique of Pierre Boulez and Karlheinz Stockhausen, that was shunned by many audiences. Then, in 1967, Bolcom anticipated the revival of ragtime when he hunted down the score to Scott Joplin's long-lost opera, Tremonitia. This inspired him to take his own hand at writing rags, and he wrote a bunch of them, 27 to be exact. They're wonderful little pieces that remove the cobwebs from 50 years' neglect, and yet are filled with modern harmonies and deeper emotional resonance and a bit of humor. Ragtime had its peak between the 1980s and, the 1890s, got that backwards, 1890s and 1910s, and features a melody for pianists broken up in short syncopated rhythms against a steady left hand in duple time. Here is William Bolcom's Graceful Ghost Rag.
Thank you.
We're going to close today with the Romanian folk dances, undoubtedly Bartok's most popular composition. The earliest version was written in 1915 and was scored for piano and orchestrated by the composer later in 1917. Several chamber music arrangements were written by other people, but authorized by Bartok. The source material derives from Bartok's enormous collection of folk music, which he began to compile in 1904 when he wrote down a melody sung by a Hungarian peasant girl. In the course of extensive travels throughout Eastern Europe, he compiled thousands of folk tunes, some of which found their way into his compositions. Here are the Romanian folk dances, arranged by Luigi Silva.
Thank you.